interesting as the other guy.
Okay, so one opinion. So Paul finds him less interesting.
I enjoy music more.
Okay, you find it more.
I find it myself better.
See, it's exactly.
But you're wrong.
Yeah, exactly. But you are wrong. And you are wrong, right? Yeah. And then you really hear a lot of that. So, yeah.
All right, what country is this man from?
He's Russian. Yep, he is Russian. Although I could find Russian pianists who play as animated as Long Lost. Absolutely. Boris Berezovsky is his name. He's a massive man, so his hands are huge. But even in terms of watching the hands, did you notice were his hands more active or less active?
Oh, more or less, no, but I noticed that when there were more sharps and flats, then his hands were up towards the back.
Absolutely, right? When you play on the black notes, what do you call that? What direction on the piano?
Up.
You could call up is sometimes considered to be right, which would be up in pitch, up in register. Down and left are kind of synonymous. So there's two other words.
Yeah.
In and out. In and out. Yeah, I think we talked about that last class, like in and out. Yeah, very good observation.
Yeah, I've watched people playing like rock music, you know, and they're playing a guitar, and they look like they're doing nothing.
Yep.
And sometimes I wonder if everybody else stopped playing, are they actually doing anything? They're like just right. They look like they're not doing anything. So that always surprises me, especially rock music.
Yeah, that's kind of part of it's a performance, you know, and to what extent are you there to entertain as opposed to portray the music? You know, it also brings up ideas of, oh, who's this about? Is it about the performer? Is it about the music? Is it about the composer? If it's about the music, are we just a spectacle that the music comes out of, or are we a performer ourselves? Are we the most important part? And I don't think those necessarily coincide with exactly how the composer feels. Like, for example, Wang Long may feel very strongly that the music is actually the most important. He's just a, you know, receptacle, and then it comes out of him.
Yeah.
But his activities are very animated. So it just really, really depends. But if you notice, if you pay close attention, there is a series of really fast notes there.
Mm-hmm.
Watch his hands. They almost hardly move, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you look to... Let's go back. I think it was right about... Oops, right about here. Like this, right? Where it's long, you know, it'd be like this. And it's not better or worse, it's very, very different.
Well, until YouTube, I mean, almost everything we heard like this was really without pictures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was kind of like it wouldn't matter what somebody looks like in a performance.
Yeah. And I mean, it also depends on then, well, what if you close your eyes and what can you hear and, you know, interpretation and how much does that influence? It's all these multifaceted things about performance that come up and these questions that are, you know, questions and they're ultimately not really answerable, I don't think. Personally, I think there's a variety of awesome options, and I may like one more the next day and one the next day.
So what about you? Are you active or still?
I'd say maybe a little bit more on the still side, probably personally, maybe slightly active. Yeah, Ruby?
Interesting enough, I performed at a competition yesterday, and it was, I was playing with a singer and a cellist, and I went and talked to the judges afterwards, and one just said, "You move too much.
Oh,
stop."
Wow.
And I went, well, that's just the way music comes out of me. And, you know, he didn't make a good point that certain times of movement interfered with my ability to sit back and listen to the sound that I was making, and that things would end up being accented because of the way my head or my body was moving. And he would say, you know, I can tell that you hear the way that phrase should go, but then your body is, it's like rope. Speed bumps. It's getting in the way of the entire.
Do you think that was accurate?
To a certain degree, yes. Yeah.
So do you think you'll change?
I think I'll be more conscious of, you know, I'm recording myself to watch, you know, is that actually coming through? Is my movement actually inhibiting what I want to, the sound that I want to make?
Is that part of change?
I don't know. I'll let you know.
Yeah. Sometimes you communicate with other musicians, right? I mean,
right.
If you're in a group.
Right, you know, certain things that you're leading off, and, you know, I have a motion that tells a singer that I'm going to be doing something, or the cellist does something towards me. So certainly collaborating, there's a lot more motion behind it.
Yeah, and I think that's, from a teacher's perspective, I think usually teachers would tell me, like, you're using too much energy. You know, and usually teachers tell you to do less. Not always, but although I've been on the opposite side too, where it's just like, oh, you're looking really stiff and like nervous, you know, and you need to loosen up and let your body feel these phrases. So I think that your physical movement certainly influences how we play influences the sound, but it's not necessarily a positive-negative relationship. So too much movement can adversely affect the sound, certainly, but also too little movement, being stiff and not moving enough, can also adversely affect your movement. So I think it's a really hard balance, and there's not one exact answer. And for Ruby, and maybe in her defense, it could have been that it affected her sound, but also it could have been a matter of taste too.
Yeah.
It could have been a combination of both. That maybe it was a real affecting of the sound, but it also could have just been that judge just really gets annoyed when he sees people, or he or she sees people move, and is sensitive to that and has to write it down. So I've definitely seen that too, where I hear really, really beautiful playing. I hear someone say, "That playing was horrible. Did you see her bass and stuff?" From really, really high level pianists. I mean, people that know better. I've done tests where someone says, oh, like Long, for example, I had a friend who said he hated him so much and always playing was just bang, bang, and all this stuff. And so I'm like, okay, I you have the right to hold that opinion. But I decided to bring a recording in and do blind listenings, and he preferred Long in the locker. So I'm like, see, just be careful what exactly you're saying and what you're listening for and how you're listening to it, because it's really easy to be overly critical and not really be aware of what you're saying and why you're saying it. So I think it's really important to be aware. And I think that's what Ruby's saying, just be conscientious and to listen to your recording. Okay, yeah, maybe this was affected here. Was it because of my physical motion? Was it fine? Was it because of the lack of physical motion? You know, so it's a really interesting and complex thing. And it is very much, I think, would you guys agree? I don't know about in voice as much, but I mean, it's a debate I hear frequently. Whenever I go to like the Clyburn competition, it's like some people love the really animated people and some people really dislike them, you know? And I would say that if anything, maybe general audiences tend to prefer more movement and classical pianists maybe tend to prefer less, but it's not mutually exclusive. But when I go to competitions, I've seen the Clyburn live a couple of times now and I hear that.
But ultimately, you're supposed to be entertaining your audience. And if most of the audience wants to see some eccentricity or flamboyance.
Yeah.
It's a hard. They're going to get really crazy just watching you sit still.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you have that, and then you have the debate of, well, are we here to entertain? Are we here to, you know, are we here to make the music in a profound way that's you know, authentic toward what the music is trying to do? And I think that, but I do think it is really important to consider the general audience, absolutely, in many different ways. In many, many, many different ways. And if you're sitting at the very back of the hall, a physical gesture can help someone perceive that sound differently. Mm-hmm. So I think as performers, regardless of whether you choose to be, this is a fact, whether you choose to be still, or whether you choose to be really active, just be very, very aware that the perception of the audience affects how they're going to hear it, and that your emotions do make a difference.
You mentioned that was from Shine, part of that?
The first one, yeah.
In the movie, mm-hmm. one of the things they were doing, sort of like the character development, is how close to the keys the guy's face was.
Sure.
Like he was like almost like breathing in the same space that
sure.
he was playing in, and that was communicating the intensity of what was going on.
Absolutely. And then you have that's true, and I think that can be really effective. You see a lot of really, really high level pianists do sort of a thing for bright, clear sound, but then you also see it's a hard balance too between what we do physically and what can injure yourself too, and our general posture, the way our bodies work. And if you're doing, you see this so much at the piano, and you hear people getting tendonitis, you know, and injuries from piano related things because you're trying so hard. Your body is storing unnecessary tension. And some people can store that. I mean, there are some pianists that have crazy tension all the time and they never ever get an injury. And then you have pianists who, you know, that tension, it really affects them. So even again, it's really hard to know exactly what's happening. But, yeah.
You probably Rachmaninoff played the piano.
Very, very, very still.
Who?
Really?
Very stoic. Rachmaninoff himself, who composed these concertos. So that's the other thing there, is like, how would the composer want to do it? Rachmaninoff was notoriously maybe stoic when he played. They said his hand position was very, very quiet. And he was they called him there was a specific description of him. He was like 6'4", 6'5".
Really?
And kind of just very stoic and rooting. I mean, this concerto was composed after 3 years of depression where he didn't write at all. And you could hear this music.
Wow.
And there's this huge triumph in the relative major, which you guys know major. This is minor, right? You can hear that darkness in the end. There's this huge triumph in C major. Maybe we can look at that actually in next class, talking about that's kind of a cool thing. But Rachmaninoff himself, very, very still. Supposedly also other performers that were very still was Liszt. He could be eccentric, his fingers were active, but they said that there was a comparison between him and another famous pianist at the time, Anton Rubinstein, and said that they both played the same piece, and at the end Liszt was like, yeah, nothing, and hadn't even broken a sweat. Anton Rubinstein also played really well, but he was like dripping sweat. And who knows, maybe he was a big man too, so it might have, but that he had to work much harder for that same sound. So a variety of styles, even within composers and within musicians themselves.
Wow.
Very, but Rachmaninoff, if anything, is very much on the on the comment of the spectrum, which kind of contrasts well our perceived romantic heroic quality of his music, which is very, very, very expressive, right?
So let me ask about what the purpose of this whole class is. Is that in our terms of our listening acuity, this would probably affect it. It's like, you know, what we're visually seeing might help me actually hear something better.
Yeah, I'm actually, I published a paper looking at how younger adults and older adults use visual cues in speech perception.
Yeah.
And they
we
use
cheat
it to
a lot.
Sorry?
We cheat a lot.
Everyone
we
does.
We look at the mouth to kind of figure out what
the child is. It turns out that young adults and older adults use have a visual benefit at about the same rate. So it's helpful across the lifespan.
Oh.
And of course, if you have the information, why wouldn't you use it? You know?
Sure. Has there been studies done as to, I know it's a stimulation of a portion of the brain, has there been studies done for different instruments, piano, guitar, whatever?
On what?
On auditory stimulation.
Does the instrument make a difference?
Yeah. Your auditory cortices are more receptive to your own instrument sounds. So you have finer discrimination when you hear, if you're a violinist and you're listening to a melody or something, you know, very technical. You'll have a finer discrimination when it's played in a violin than if it's in a piano. So your brain is shaped by those experiences.
Very neat.
Cool. Yeah, all fascinating stuff. So yeah, when you're watching a performance and listening, you know, that's something else you could be paying attention to. Oh, what does this performer do? You know, how does that affect my reaction? Everybody's might not be the same. But respect that they might have a very good reason for what they're doing too.
I just realized another little bit is when you see the little kids, the prodigies that are 5 years old playing.
Sure.
In my mind, I think you're really cutting them a lot of slack. You know, because they're little, because I see that it's a tiny little player.
Uh-huh.
I'm thinking that's amazing that little hand can do that. So I'm giving them a huge benefit of the doubt in addition to the how they sound. It's like it's amazing that they can even do that.
I think that we do maybe. Give kids more of a benefit of the doubt. However, man, child prodigies. I can play you a recording right now of 11-year-old Ho Chen Chang, who won the Clyburn, not this one, but the one before, playing all the Opus 10 etudes, which is a feat for any professional pianist to do. And it's not just that he plays them. If I did not have a visual of him, I would think that it's a professional recording. Yevgeny Kissin, the name I mentioned earlier that you guys, no one knew the name, which is normal, no one knows, he's not mainstream, recorded both the Chopin concertos with the Warsaw Philharmonic when he's 12, and they're released recordings. Yeah, and so, I mean, there's also that too.
Wow.
Yeah, I'll do that with you guys a little bit in class on Wednesday as well. That's an interesting thing to do, an entirely different thing, but prodigiousness and child prodigies and all those things. We discussed a little bit last time, and one of those tangents we don't spend too much time on, but it's worth at least looking at briefly, right? So yeah, good point. All right, let's do a little bit of piano time here. Get this thing, I hope you're inspired by all those fast makers, right?
Yeah.
And what I want to do today is I want to do a little bit of work on scales and a little bit of work on learning how scales kind of work with some numbers. And then what I want to do is actually spend part of the end of the class is kind of going over what we've done so far, because some of you have two things in mind, like, wait, what was that term? I've done it. You know, how do we get good at things? It's through repetition. And it's through going over them again. So some of these things aren't really going to stick, right, initially, but you go over them a couple of times, you'll start to be there. But I want to do a little bit of a review. I think you'll be really surprised at what you have learned so far and how those things are coming together, and that'll kind of be familiar. And that'll also help you get you some of you like, well, we don't really have a way you can look up all the terms, but if you look at all those review sheets, we're gonna kind of go through them quickly and kind of give you some ways to go through those on your own to kind of review things. I think that'll be good, okay? Back to tonality. So that's kind of a word we haven't really discussed yet, but tonality and all these different things, another thing that comes with these things, tonality, diatonic, not being used as diabolical or something, it seems like that, diatonic, and key, and major, and minor, all these things are kind of from the same realm of how we organize music, how we organize classical music. And they kind of come under this general thing of what we call tonality. That's how we organize the pitches. So one of the most fundamental and organizing features of tonality, as we call it, is the major and minor scales. We're gonna go back to major today. And we set up a major scale in the form of two what?
Tetrachords.
Yes. Bing, bing, bing. Prize for that, yeah. Two tetrachords, yeah. You can win a prize for that. Two tetrachords. The first tetrachord being in the left hand, fingers 4, 3, 2, 1. Fourth finger starts on what then? If we're going to go all white notes. C major. Okay, C, yeah.
D.
Yep, C, D. E, F. First tetrachord, second tetrachord starts on G, right? G, A, B, C. Okay, can everybody set up in that position? So, C, E, F with the left hand. Okay, one. We're gonna play quarter notes. What's that? It doesn't matter what C you're on, actually. So, whatever C you want. One, two, three, four, one, two, ready, play. C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. Looks pretty good, excellent. C major scale, you just need it. Nailed it. Can we play it two different ways? I've seen a variety of different touches going on. The first one, can we play it if these are the notes here? Okay. Yeah. What is that called?
Slur,
which means to play in what sort of a manner?
Tied together.
Legato. Good. All those are good. Connected. Smooth. Okay. Let's play in a legato manner. And one more time. One, two, ready, play. Couple of fourth fingers in the left hand and the wrong note there. So everybody's fourth finger on C.
Yeah.
All right, and the thumb of the right hand is on F. The thumbs are on adjacent notes, F and G. All right, let's try that one more time. So left hand thumbs on F, right hand thumbs on G.
And you know what I find is some of them, because they have stronger fingers than others. Right,
yeah.
And all of a sudden it's
real
quiet.
Absolutely, yep. You and everybody else play piano. This is somewhere constantly we're finding. Anatomically speaking, I don't know if I mentioned this, you know, these are connected by the same tendon. It's not our fault. We were designed that way. So we have to work extra hard with the fourth and the fingers and the third and fourth. So okay. Same thing, legato. One, I'm gonna give you two measures, we're gonna play quarter notes. One, two, three, four, one, two, ready, play. Crescendo, but getting going up, right?
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of an active going up. Let's go down now. Can we go in reverse order?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, starting with the fourth finger of your right hand, then descending. All right, one, two, three, four, one, two, ready, play. C, ascending and descending. Okay? And that was played in what manner again?
Legato.
Legato. You can always imagine kind of a singing quality with that. Speaking of in and out at the piano, so what am I right now? Would you call this probably?
Out.
No?
In.
Okay? Yeah. When we play all white notes, it's going to kind of stay out. Stay out. You don't want to be playing this scale like this here. And that was a really good observation by Marsha. When we were like in, out, but when we play black notes, then we have to kind of move in, right? When we did the A flat major scale last time. But with all these notes like this, somewhere about here is your thumb. Thumb's gonna line up, somewhere in this area should be good. Because it's just the easiest. And then when we have to have a black note, then that's when you start to move in and get those. Okay? Let's try the same thing. Can we do it with a staccato touch? Ding, ding, ding. Don't. So you can kind of do a staccato, kind of a thump, boom. Think of the wrist as kind of helping this as a drum, boom, boom, but this needs to be, so just a little bit of thump, thump,
staccato,
thump, 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 thump. Imagine a string kind of plucking, call that pizzicato, thump, thump, all right? See if you can make that same sound on the piano. Do not rush, everybody's gonna rush, okay? One, two, three, four, one, and two, three, and four. let's try descending. One, two, three, four, one, two, descending. Go. Yeah, whenever you play short, we're always going to speed up music majors to everybody alike, because you have all that space, like, hey, all this space, I can go faster, right? One more time, can you all subdivide within that? So think one, two, three, and four. One, two, three, and four. Can you think of that while you're doing it to prevent the rushing? So give that space.
Oh.
One, and two, and three, and four, and one, and two. And, oh, so I'll give you just one measure this time. One, and two, and ready, and good. Okay, and descending, playing staccato. One, two, and three, and sub to five. Excellent. And now I want to do that same thing. Can we move that left hand fourth finger up to G? All right, so we have that first tetrachord with the fourth finger on G, right? And what should the notes then be? So we got key note, then what type of a step? Whole. Uh-huh. So key note, and then a whole, and then what? Whole. And then half. Good. Right? So keynote is going to be G in this case. And then G up to A is a whole step. A up to B is a
whole step.
All right? And then B up to C is a
half step.
All right? And then what about between the two tetrachords? What time of a step do we have? Do you remember? Yes. Good. A whole step, which is going to bring us up to
D.
Mm-hmm. And then we're going to do that same sort of intervallic content for that second tetrachord. And first tetrachord, key note here, all right, then.
What is that note? That's...
So this is going to be what note then?
E.
D right now, right? D. Right, so we've got G, whole step, half step. Whole step between the tetrachords, so starting on D, and then D, whole step up from D is
E.
Whole step up from E is
F sharp.
Yes, nice, nailed it. F sharp, and a half step up from F sharp is
G.
Excellent. That is a G major scale. Yeah, you just modulated. Okay, let's play that one in a legato manner with quarter notes. I'm gonna give you two measures. One, two, three, four. One, two. Try that one more time.
It's with an F sharp.
Yes, so it's going to be G, A, and then what? Can okay. You sing with me? G, A, B, C,
wait. Oh, this isn't the last
note,
so
it's a whole step.
Yeah,
that's
perfect. Let's play that legato. One measure of counted. One, two, three, four, one. Good. And let's go descending in G major. One, two, three, four, one, two. Ready, play. Key of G,
mm-hmm.
What do we need to add?
The sharps.
Which one?
The F sharp.
F sharp. And what do we call this then? Do you know what we call
the signature?
Yes, exactly. Key signature. This is called a key signature. Key signature. And that is also in your book too, in the theory book. Key signature. And F sharp, okay? Let's do one more. Everybody move up your fourth finger to D.
But you put that key signature near the F letter, in front of the F letter, or
this
right
is,
there?
Yep, this is on F, right? So that is right now telling me that every F I see is going to be an F sharp. So I'm going to write a nice little melody for you.
So you put it on where the F letter, where the note is?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Just like a note goes on the line that
the signature goes on. The key signature goes on the line. Okay, got it.
Oh, girl.
Okay, so let's do this note. And what is this note going to be?
Sharp.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the melody would sound like this. One, two, ready, go.
A sharp, G, F sharp, D, F sharp, F sharp, G.
Yeah, so all those Fs are sharp because this key signature right here. Yes? And that's on, this note is what?
F.
F, yeah, exactly. So that sharp is right in the middle of that sharp, is that F. So that means all Fs are sharp.
But why wouldn't you put it down in the first open space?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So why don't we put it here? Is that what your question is? Yeah, that's just a matter of practice. There is no reason, to be honest.
Okay.
Yeah, no reason. Yeah. No reason. It's completely arbitrary. Like, why do we start with A for the L? Nobody knows, you know. We just do. This would be fine, though, too. And actually, sometimes if you look at older scores, you will see the sharp down here. Okay. But it's become standard nowadays to put the sharp here and the way they go. Okay?
Yep.
Good. Actually, do you want to try and read this? Can we try and read this?
Mm-hmm.
I would love to try and read this. Can we put the third finger of your right hand on this? F sharp. Which F sharp is this?
The
good every spin one?
Middle.
Yep, F sharp above middle C.
Yes.
Good. What finger would probably be good to put on that G then?
Fourth finger,
right? Of the right hand. So it goes up, that's all right. Yeah, if you're using the right hand, if you're using your left hand, you'd be right. Okay, so fourth finger of your right hand. And what probably would be a good finger for that D then? Thumb, right? Thumb, because the second finger is probably going to be hanging out of that E, which we skipped. So we have step, 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 skip, skip, and then you're going to say step. Okay, now the third, the fourth fingers and the thumb, you have all the fingers necessary to play this example. And we're reading on the staff, okay? Let's give this a shot. I'm gonna give you two measures of count in. One, two, three, four. One, two, ready, flip. Good. There were a couple of F naturals in there, but that was quite good. And what is this then again?
Slur.
Yep, slur and legato. Let's do that one more time. Third finger on F sharp above middle C. One, two, three, four. One, two, ready, play. Good. Nice. Give yourself a hand. You just played in the key of G.
All right.
Awesome. And move those four fingers up again. I want to move everybody's fourth finger up to a starting note of D now. Okay, D. Keynote is D. Whole step up from D.
E.
Okay, with your third finger, whole step up from E. Excellent. Half step up from F sharp.
G.
Nailed it. And whole step then up from G. Okay, with your right hand now coming in. So far, E, F sharp, G. All right, with the left hand, D, E, F sharp, G. Notice how third and fourth, let's actually make an artificial barrier here. We're talking about in and out. Let's say that this right here, the black notes, let's call that a door into the house. The white notes are outside. Anything in here is inside the house, okay? For a good hand position for D, it's going to feel a little bit weird, but both the fourth and the third fingers are going to be outside of the house. That second finger is going to be in the house.
Yeah.
Thumb's going to be out of the house.
Yeah.
Okay, good. And then we've got to A, half step up, or sorry, A, whole step up from A. B, whole step up from B.
C sharp.
C sharp, good. Half step up from C sharp.
D.
D, back to D.
Put your hands back out now.
Yep, so we've got out. out of the house, in the house, out of the house. So left hand kind of looks like this, right? Okay. Right hand.
You drop your wrist.
What's that?
You're dropping your wrist. Well, I'm trying to figure out how you're making
it. It's because I'm playing with this thing, so it would be more.
Okay, well, okay, so you don't have much trouble reaching.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I mean, you want to have a good.
Drop your wrist, but it's really straight.
Your wrist, your hands just looks great, actually. That looks good. You don't want to have your wrist to be too low. Generally, you want to have this sort of wrist. Good. Your wrist looks straight. Okay, then A, B, C sharp is in the house. Fourth finger is outside of the house. So I know that feels a little bit weird getting used to that, but that is that D major kind of position. Right? So the only notes that are inside the house are those black notes for hand position. Looking good. Okay, let's play this one. D major in a nice legato manner. One, two, three, four. One, two, ready, play. Let's do descending D major. One, two, three, four. One, two, ready, play. That was the Canada D modulation. Okay, so bum, bum, there we go. In the key of D, excellent. I want to do one more while we're at it. Let's move our hands up to A. A, okay. Key note is A on the fourth finger of your left hand. Whole step up from A.
There we go.
B.
B.
Good. Whole step up from B.
C.
Uh-huh. So right now we have A, B, and C sharp. Okay, half step up from C sharp.
D.
D. Good. And a whole step up from D.
E.
E. Right? And that's going to start your right hand now, that second tetrachord. Whole step up from E.
F sharp.
Whole step up from F sharp.
G sharp.
F sharp. Whole step up from F sharp.
G sharp.
G sharp, right? Okay. G sharp. F sharp to G sharp. Whole step. And then half step.
A.
Okay, so the notes from bottom to top. A, B, C sharp. D, left hand, E, F sharp, G sharp, A. Okay. What's that? Yeah, I got Canada really short. Okay, should we try that one more? Everybody get that hand position? So the bottom tetrachord is A, B, C sharp, D, left hand. Okay, right hand, E, F sharp, G sharp, A. All right, let's do it. A major it is. One, two, three, four. One, two, ready, play. Two, three. G sharp, A. Good. And let's do descending. One, two, ready, play. How many black notes do you have in that one?
Three.
Uh-huh. How many black notes did you have in D?
Two.
Good. Some habits. There's a pattern. That's what we're doing.
Really?
You're right? Yeah.
I thought
pattern.
It was swollen. Yeah.
Okay. Pattern. And then we kept F sharp and we added C sharp with D. And then what did we just add? What was the new sharp?
G sharp.
G sharp. Yeah. So here's the key signature for G. Here's the key signature for D. Here's the key signature for A.
Oh, wow.
Guess what? So is there a pattern to that? We went from C to G to D to A. Can you find any pattern in that? Look at your keyboard. Oh, don't play, but just look. I'll give you guys about a minute to think about this. And if you get it, that's good. We'll talk about it. Okay, C is the first one with no sharps. G.
One
I'm going to brighten it up here. So C, G, D, A, and E. We haven't got E yet, but we're just, that would be the next one in the step. Okay, don't play though. Just kind of Search around. See if you can find a pattern. It might take you. Yeah, okay, it seems like a lot of people are getting, I was going to wait for everybody to, but that's awesome, you guys are getting it. You're exactly right, yeah. These are all a fifth, okay? A fifth apart. C to G is a fifth. G to D, fifth, right? D to A, fifth. A to E, fifth. And we have a fun little thing for music. You guys are getting into music major territory here, so here's something. The element, and you really did that well. It's called the circle of fifths. Circle of fifths. So you're kind of thinking of it as drawing a nice clock. Ooh, that's not a very nice clock. So that is a, not a nice clock, but it's a clock. Oh, goodness, the book.
Page 25.
And what's that?
Page 25.
25, thanks. It was 45. You get out your theory book. This one just broke.
25. Well.
Okay, so that is the circle of fifths on page 25. There you can look at that drawn out. And the way that that works then is, one thing that's not noted there is, so C, the only thing is it doesn't start at 12 o'clock, it starts at 0 o'clock. So it'll be a kind of a military time, okay? So C is 0 o'clock. All right, 1 o'clock equals 1 sharp, which is? So G equals, yeah, it has that F sharp, that first sharp is F sharp 1, and then D has how many sharps?
2.
2. A has, E has, and then what would have 5s? B. B, yep, B has 5 o'clock, yep. That is the circle of fifths. And the reason that works is because how many distinct notes are on the piano? Go ahead and count them. Different notes.
Oh,
what?
You mean
per octave? Yes, just, yeah, per octave.
Per octave.
In a scale, that's right, 7. What about all together? So if you count, start at C and count until you get back to
13.
C.
6.
Yes.
What is
that? Oh, so from here to here.
12.
Yeah, you get 12. I know what you're thinking is the thing. So 1. So here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's why it works really well with a clock, right? Because all of those have a corresponding key signature. Awesome. And so we're just going to work on this for now, but the way we can do it is we also have sharps. You also have flats. And so F has 1 flat.
Oh, yeah.
And you go the opposite direction, so C down to F is down a fifth. You get 1 flat. 2 flats is the key of B flat. Alright? Then 3 flats is the key of B flat, etc. You can see where that goes there. The flats. And all of these, what holds all these together is that note that you start on, all is this. Whole step, half step, whole. Whole, whole, half, okay? So look at this quickly then. What do you call that at the bottom of the circle of fifths here? So the next up a perfect fifth for B is F sharp. That's how we get there. Because that ends up being, notice how many half steps are there between C and G? Can you count that for me? So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? 7 half steps. So between there, and then G to D, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yep, so there's always 7 half steps. When you get from B, what happens if you count from B to F? That next one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's because there's only 2 black notes in the middle. So that's why we have to go up to here for that next note. So when we go from here, 7 half steps, 7 half steps, 7 half steps, 7 half steps, 7 half steps. 7 half steps. That's why you're probably wondering, well, why doesn't this get to F? Right? Why doesn't it get to F? It's because you need to go up one more to keep going on things, which is F sharp here. Okay? Notice then, F sharp, what is it also written as?
G flat.
Do you remember the name for that?
Oh, harmonic.
You're really, really close. That's the second half of it. Yeah, that's the second half. There's one little prefix that goes with that.
You in harmonic.
Yes. Good, Catherine. Nailed it. Absolutely. All right. Enharmonic spelling. So that's why they both occupy 6 o'clock. They're the same note, but they can be spelled. Yeah, really excellent work. That's exactly right. So let's play this one just for fun. Can everybody start on, what do we want to do first? F sharp or G flat? Let's do F sharp, okay? F sharp. So F sharp, fourth finger of your left hand on F sharp. Start that first tetrachord, okay? Whole step up from F sharp.
G sharp.
Whole step up from G sharp.
A sharp.
A sharp. Half step up from A sharp.
B.
B, right? Half step up from A sharp. And it has to be consecutive letters, so A has to go to B.
That's right.
Okay? Whole step up from B.
C sharp.
C sharp, good. Whole step.
D sharp.
Whole step. This is weird. Good, F. Except for, if we just went from D, do we go to F? So this is the weird one, that's right? So we can't go from D to F, so we looked, skip, poor D, or poor E got left out.
Yeah.
So we haven't had an E in there, so what kind of E is it going to be?
E flat.
It's
the same one.
So it's this note, everybody agrees it's this note, F, right? So what is the enharmonic spelling of that? If we went from F, G, A, B, C, D, this has to be some sort of a what?
Oh, E flat.
An E? If I make an E flat,
oh,
then,
yeah.
Oh,
sharp, sharp.
Yeah, got it. Yeah, exactly.
What?
I know. What? Crazy, right?
Didn't care.
F. It can also be E sharp. Yep, an enharmonic spelling or enharmonic.
Oh, yeah.
Yep, remember? So this could also be, this is what note? First of all, normally B. It could also be called what?
C flat.
C flat, good. This could also, this is,
C.
This could also be called
B sharp.
Yes.
B sharp.
All right. This could also be called
E.
And
or F flat.
F flat, right? This is F or
E sharp.
F or
E sharp.
E sharp. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, those things. Okay, good. Yeah. Question?
This is a question about fingering, and it's just I'm confused because when I took piano in fourth grade, you know, if we were in the key of G,
mm-hmm.
we played that scale in key, you know, this finger, the pinky, always started on G, and we went up, and you had to cross over like this.
Sure.
But is that like, I mean, it was hard to do that. We had to practice, you know, turning our thumb. And
that's exactly right. That's why we're waiting on that, because it's kind of
okay.
Hard.
All right.
Exactly.
Well,
right.
I just didn't know. I thought this was some new way of
No, but right now what we're doing is reinforcing those two tetrachords.
Okay.
Right, how they
all
link
right.
together, which
okay.
is why it conveniently fits with these four fingers. Yes, we can play scales with a single hand too.
Yeah,
so,
okay.
For example, and we will get there. I was going to teach you guys scale fingers on Wednesday for individual hands. But for example, E major, this is my right hand, right? Yeah, there's a way to make that work. And it's not, you can't just go, how does that work, you know? So here's C major, here's hands together. Okay, that's the way that things work together. And there are fingerings that correspond with that. And I wasn't doing this, right? So you're exactly right. There are scale fingerings that you will learn soon. But for right now, can we just focus on these?
Yeah, I just want to make...
That's a really good point, though.
Okay.
Yep, and we will get there. For some of these, at least. Okay, so here, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, and B.
F sharp,
C sharp, D sharp, E sharp, and F sharp. All right, can you get your hand set up like this then? So start with that black note there, F-sharp.
So we're going to be up in the house
with the thumb. Yeah, you're going to be up in the house with almost all of the notes except for that thumb on the left hand. Good. Absolutely, inside the house. That third finger is going to be inside the house too, okay? Let's give this a try. We'll see how it goes, and then we might fix it. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, ready, play.
F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, E sharp, F sharp, F sharp.
Good. Make sure that third finger plays in the middle here. It's kind of, those are tied together, the third and fourth fingers. But make sure those play together. Or I'm sure, make sure you don't skip that third finger of your right hand. I think that happened for some of you. Let's try it again.
Third finger of the right hand.
Third finger of the right hand is on what note?
I don't know.
Okay, well, that will help then.
E sharp.
Yes. Got it. E sharp. It's going to be that half sharp, which is the same as F.
That's right.
Exactly.
And the last one is F sharp.
Yep.
Third finger
of the right hand is on E sharp. Good.
It's E sharp and the left sharp. On right after it. So the right.
Got. So it's still good.
The other
way
you're actually E sharp.
It's the half.
It's tight.
Yeah.
Tight.
Good. Perfect. We got it. Now we're good shape. One, two, three, four, one, two, ready, play. F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, E, C sharp, D sharp, E sharp, F sharp. Yay! Just played with six sharps. Awesome. And let's do descending.
Oh, jeez.
I know everybody's like, yes, and you took your hands off of it. That's all right.
Don't do that.
All right. That's right. We can reset them.
Okay.
I'll give you a minute. Yeah, I think you can. You're very capable. Okay, let's do descending. One, two, three, four, one, two. Let's get seeing everybody set up one more time. So from bottom or from top to bottom, it'd be F sharp, E sharp, D sharp, C sharp, B, A sharp, G sharp, F sharp. What's that?
Ascending or descending?
This is F sharp major.
Are we ascending?
Descending. We're gonna go descending.
Let's go down.
Down. One, two, three. Four, one, two, ready, go! Actually, that confused you guys, that's my fault. We're going descending. I'm gonna give you one measure count in. One, two, ready, play! Huge concepts right here. So spend some time kind of looking at that, but that's so impressive. I really, honestly, when I was teaching, I didn't think it would go so quickly. Like, you guys are doing way beyond what I expected. So congrats. Question.
So if you have a major and you say F sharp major,
yep.
Then it goes whole, whole, half, whole, 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 half for all of them.
Yep.
If you have G and that's G major, then it goes whole, whole, half, whole, 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 half.
Yeah. It's the formula, exactly.
Oh,
yeah. Awesome, right?
Where was that? Where is that?
That's on page 31.
Oh,
if you wanted to check that out in that book. What's really cool then, that is what then defines a major key.
Okay.
Right? All those notes, that pitch collection, and their interaction actually is going to be also important too, but the interaction of that pitch collection is things. So
pitch collection means what?
Pitch collection, good, very good question. Pitch collection. So how many notes do we have in this? Any major scale, what is the pitch collection?
Eight.
Yeah, eight and or seven distinct
seven.
Notes, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1. Okay, and
okay.
Repeat. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? All the way up. Excellent. Notice how I had a letter for every single letter. So it started on C, but we had A, B, C, D, E, F, G. We had all of those notes.
Okay.
Just in a different order. And D also has D,
E, F sharp, G, A, B, C sharp, D.
Alright, we have all those letter names there. So every single major scale is going to have all of the letter names attached. So that's a good.
Okay.
Why, for example, we went F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, B, C sharp, D sharp. You can't go to F because poor E gets left out. You have to go to an E. The letter names define that, right? So that's why it has to be spelled as E sharp. It's because you have to go to an E. You can't skip a letter.
Okay.
Against
okay,
the rules.
Got it.
Okay?
Yep.
And then back to F sharp. Good. Yes, Catherine?
I still don't quite get why. Okay, the pentachords, one's tonic, one's dominant.
Okay, yeah, we're going to get to that actually today.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, those that terminology, we'll get to that. Yeah, good question. In short, though, we're going to get that tonic and dominant. So if we have tonic and we call that the opening, if we call this first one tonic, and that's one, what did that dominant one start on? What number of the scale? This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the bottom tetrachord, it starts on 1. So it's 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
If we go up in terms of numbers, that's the bottom tetrachord, then what is that? This one starts on what number?
5.
Yep. So actually, tonic and 1 are synonymous. And dominant and 5, I think they kind of mean, yeah, different things. So yeah, that's in short, we're going to get all of those in between that are though. So, good question?
Okay, so I was trying to turn off the sharps because we should have, you know, going 5 and then 6, but there
sure.
were actually 7 sharps, right? There were 6 black keys and then the E sharp.
Yeah, exactly.
So what are we saying there?
So how many sharps are there then? We have F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, so that's 3. B is natural. Right?
Oh, right.
And then we have C sharp, D sharp, and E sharp, and F sharp.
Oh.
Because the F sharp has already been there, start there, yeah?
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
And if we wanted to do, actually, if you look in your book then, there is an equivalent for 7. It's C sharp. Has all the sharps possible. You can't have more than 7 sharps.
Wow.
There's the final one. Yeah. And then what you get is, just quickly, we don't have to do it together, but you can kind of go along with me. Is C sharp, so starting there. C sharp, D sharp, and then a whole step up from D sharp is what?
D sharp, E sharp.
B as in boy or E as in egg?
E is
E. E's an egg, yep. E sharp, and then F sharp. And then G sharp, A sharp, and then a whole step up from A sharp is what?
I mean, a C, regular C.
B sharp.
A sharp. From A sharp. So A, if it goes up from A, it has to be what letter?
B sharp.
Has to be exactly
B
sharp. Yep, so in that case, we have all 7 sharps. We have C sharp, G sharp, E sharp, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, B sharp, C sharp. Yeah, kind of strange, right? And that's it. That's all you'll ever have to know with keys. There are not any more sharp keys. Only these 7. Ever. Cool, huh? You would never have to learn another sharp key. See, that's the thing that they don't put, is kind of like this one. So what would be D flat and C sharp or what, Catherine? You're the one.
Oh, in harmonic.
Yeah, good.
Okay.
And then B actually has its inharmonic equivalent of C flat. Yep. So that's how it works. That's one thing that's missing from your book. The way it works there. So there are these ones right here, twin keys, the way it can work there. Okay? Good. And we're going to do a little bit of review on woods. I'm going to change that. I want to continue with what we're doing here with this. Can we go back to C major? There's one thing about, okay, so the pitch collection, that series of 7 notes, right, that we call diatonic, that we call all these things, okay? They are grouped together. They have different kind of functions. They can be grouped. You remember the very first week of class when we played?
Oh, the higher scale.
Good.
The harp song.
Guess what? You're going to be able to understand what that is. Alright, you're going to know what that harp scale is. So when you had, can you guys remember the harp song? It's actually on review sheet number 1. It's not number 1, I think. I have it. I wrote that down, but I don't know. Maybe number 2. Yeah, harp song is on review sheet number 1. If you look on the second page of review sheet number 1. Okay? If you don't have that with you, it's not that big of a deal. If you can locate it quickly, great. If not, I'm going to write it up here anyway. So we just did all stepwise motion, right? We have a thing, all of these, guess what? These are called chords. Yes! Chords. We're going to be playing chords. as notes happen at the same time. Specifically, what we're going to be playing is, there are different types of chords. The type of chord that we're going to be focusing on is a subset of chords, which we call triads. Anybody guess what a triad might mean?
Three,
right? Yeah. It's the tricycles of music, okay? Three notes. Specifically, the way that would work in the key of C major, so we'll go here with the treble clef. And the treble clef, those first notes you guys played in the harp song were C, E, G. Right? So you play a note, skip a note, play a note, skip a note, play a note. Can everybody with your right hand play these specific three notes? So what C is this? Middle C. C, and then next note is
G.
It's a triad. That right here is a C major triad. Yay! C major triad. C major. Who all wants to hear Anton speak? Did anybody get to go watch him play and speak? A few of you? Okay, cool. So I noticed that he played the Waldstein Sonata. Right at the beginning. Did he, I think he played that forever. I said,
Right?
Guess what those opening notes are. Everybody can play your C, E, and G with me, okay? And I'm gonna start to play 1, 2, 3, 4. Just play 1, 2. Play that. Go. Yeah, hey, you're starting the beginning of the C major sonata.
All right. Okay.
That is a sonata in C major. The opening notes are C, E, G. I played C, E, and G kind of down here, but that's still C, G, and E, right? Good. C major. Okay. Now what we do next, can you move up your hand to a D? Okay. And then play D, and then you're going to skip what?
E.
Yep. And then you're going to play
F.
Yep. And then you're going to skip G and play
A.
Okay. Can everybody play that triad now for me? One.
Just one hand.
Just these specific notes right here. So above middle C, right hand. What's that? I'm sorry?
Like a chord.
Yeah, like a chord, all at once. So this means when you see something like this, they're playing simultaneously, right? That good point. And clarify that. So it could be like this with whole notes. It could be like this with half notes. It could be like this with quarter notes, right? But they occur vertically. Something that happens on piano and not so much on a lot of other instruments, right? As much. Okay? Let's play that. 1, 2, ready, play. Okay. Yeah, good.
So we're playing the three notes all at one time.
Okay. Three notes at the same time. So D, F, and A. We always read from bottom to top in music. Bottom to top. Okay. Bottom to top. Kind of, we're used to always kind of top to bottom approach. This is the bottom to top. 1, 2, ready, play. Okay, some people are a little bit low. Can we specifically have the D above middle C with your right hand thumb? 1, 3, 5.
1, 3, 5.
Okay, 1, 2, ready, play. Yeah, no worries. Okay. What about that? Does that sound different or the same than the first one?
Sounds like a minor.
Different. Yeah, that is actually minor. So this one is going to be D minor. It does sound. Okay, and then next one, can we do the next one? It's going to be E, and then what?
F.
We're going to skip F and play
G.
Uh-huh. We're going to skip what?
B and B. A and go C.
Skip A and play B. All right, let's try that one. 1, 2, ready, play. Major or minor?
Minor.
Minor. Good. E. Notice how I use a lowercase E for the minor and D for minor. That's not always the case. It's just one way of doing it. The uppercase M usually also means major, and the lowercase M usually means minor. Sometimes you'll see this, but there's different ways of notating this. So just don't take that as the only way this can be done. I'm doing that to really over-exaggerate things, but it's not always notated that way. Okay, next one. We start with F, and then
A,
And
C.
F, A, C. Let's play that one. you.
Major.
Brighter?
Major.
Major. Good. Here's
Major brighter.
Major brighter. F. Major. Yep. Okay, next one.
G.
G.
B.
B.
D. Uh-huh.
D. D.
One, two, ready, play. Major. G. Major. And next one, A.
C. E.
Good. Okay, let's play it exactly where it was. Two, ready, play. A minor, yep. Okay, next one. B.
D.
D.
A. F.
One, two, ready, play. Okay, I want everybody to just play your first and your fifth fingers. Pretty or ugly?
That's pretty.
Okay, Paul likes it, maybe because he used it.
It's interesting.
Okay, specifically, you know what we call that? And I'm going to teach this because I think it's kind of interesting. If we count from B to E, so keno, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 half steps, that is exactly in the middle of 12, right? Yeah, in the middle of 12. What if we count, do that same thing from C up to G, like from this one to C up to G? Okay, so keno, everybody count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. D to A, let's do that one. Ready? Go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, E to B. Ready? Go. Keno. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, back to B. Ready? Go. Keno. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's a different interval than the rest of them. Even though it's white to white and you skip 2, 3 black notes, notice there's only 2 black notes in the middle of this. This one, 3 black notes in the middle. 3 black notes in the middle. 3 black notes in the middle, 3 black notes in the middle, 3 black notes in the middle, 3 black. Those 2 black notes, the asymmetry of the piano, results in this is what we call tritone. A tritone, a tritone.
The B to the F interval is what he's referring to.
B to F is tritone. You know what they used to call that back in the Middle Ages? It was called the devil. So they completely avoided writing music with that.
Oh.
Yeah, so they would not do that interval. To have this interval would invoke the devil. That's what they thought, you know, at the time. So it actually was taboo to use this. So they would not have this interval. This one's a weird one. There's only one of these that occurs in every scale. This triad is called B diminished. It's a weird one. And that one is different than all the other ones. So we have major, minor, minor, major, major, minor. Weird. Okay? Weird. That sound, that diminished sound is something. So the opening of, for example, Liszt, you guys have heard of Franz Liszt, right? I think he did a... That one, yeah, that's Liszt, famous for his virtuosity, all of those notes. He wrote a thing called the Dante Sonata. What does Dante have to do with the Dante's Inferno?
Yeah.
Purgatory, hell, all those things. Guess what the opening notes are, I want to play for you. Can we count them? 0, 1. Tritone. Can you hear that sound? It's not. Very different, right? So he's specifically and intentionally evoking that kind of devil sound. Anyway, it's also kind of a devil to learn.
Yeah, the European ambulances alternate on a tritone because it's very jarring. It's very jarring.
Yeah,
as they go by, the doctor in fact needs to modulate. They go in. Okay, guess what? These are all within C major. We call these that word that I wrote a little while ago. These are called diatonic. And we're going to get to a sheet with all this stuff, so we'll review it, triads. Don't really be so much worried about the names right now. Just kind of experiment with those sounds and be going through it. Experiment with those sounds. Okay, diatonic, triads. Can you help me circle which ones we use in the harp song?
Circle which groups you use the harp song.
Okay. What was the next one?
C.
F A C.
C
major.
F A C.
G.
G. G. Yep. Those three triads are what constitute the entire harp song. Yeah?
Yeah.
And guess what else we can do? Remember another thing that had a really repetitive pattern of chords? Well, there's been two things actually in class. You can say either one. One thing that was like the same thing over and over again. The title, Axis of Awesome, what kind of a song? We play.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, the Axis of Awesome. How many different notes were there?
Four.
Okay. So those ones would be actually in the keys. It would be C. So we'll talk about but the chords of that. G, A, F, C, G, A, F. Can everybody play that with me? We're gonna do it. Not out of time. We'll be out of time. Just play the triads with me. So we're going to start on the C here, above, or middle C here. Ready? Play that one. Okay, C. And then we're going to go down, actually, to a G triad. The G triad, you know that? G, B, D. Okay, one, two, ready, play. G. Okay, and then up to A. One, two, ready, play. Okay, prepared. Last one is F. One, two, ready, play. F. Back up to C. G. Down to G. Up to A. Down to F. Up to C. Down to G. Up to A. Down to F, up to C, up to G, sorry, up to A, down to F. All right, good. So as that one is, I just transpose. You guys went. Adele, right? Yep, that's all dialed in. So it's C. Transpose that to any of those keys that we did. So you can do that same thing that we just did. You can do that with G, you can do that with D, you can do that with A, you can do that with E. They all have their corresponding diatonic triads. Kirsten?
So why aren't we putting any sharps or flats in any of these keys? Mm-hmm. Why aren't we doing that?
Because it's based on C major?
Yes, and
good.
How many sharps and flats are in C major?
None.
So if you did transpose it to D or G, you would have to add in the sharps accordingly, okay?
Yeah. So that would be there. I'll get you a printout of these things. So we will make something with this. The book has introduces triads, but I don't really like the way it introduces them. You can look at it. It's on page 42, I think. It will at least show you what a triad is, but it introduces inversions right away. And so you can look at that if you want to, but we're not going to discuss that yet. It's on page 42. And you can look at that. And it's worth looking at, but this is something a little bit beyond and different from what the book does. So these are called diatonic triads. Yep. That's key signature and doing the things in the major key signature for those things. And we will get that too, so don't worry about that for homework yet either. But just know that that is there. Paul?
I just want to calculate how stupid I am.
No such thing.
Does somebody actually go through this book in order and learn stuff, or is it all done as reference we jump around?
That's a really good question. You know, it doesn't matter. You could go through this methodically and learn everything in order. You could also have it tangentially related. You know, curriculums and how you learn music, there are so many different things to learn that there's no one way of deciding what gets learned first in the order they go. Some things can't be learned before others. Like, I couldn't teach you about secondary dominance and these things before I teach about key, right? So there are some order. But other than that, there's so many different ways you can go. It depends on your focus. So that's a really good question.
Is this, on our final exam?
Yes. And if you fail, death penalty.
Oh, man.
It's really high stakes here.
Is a root always the whole note?
In terms of the value?
Yes.
No, these can all be the same. So notice how here, these are all quarter notes, right? If you look up here, Marcia, see how these are all, I wrote these as quarter notes, actually. Yeah. So that's just a way of notating the notes. So what they're concerned with there is the pitch. Right, so where these exist on the staff, I could also write a C major triad like this. That's also a C major, even though the durational value changed. Okay, so that's a different. This deals with this whole note is with rhythm, right? Quarter note is with rhythm. Half note is with rhythm. C E G D F A. That's pitch.
Looking at inversions, and so they're...
Yeah, don't worry about that right now.
Oh, okay.
Don't worry about those. That's why I was saying I don't like page 42 very much.
Oh.
So you can look at it, but when it says inversions, don't worry about that right now. If you're curious, look at it, but we're going to deal with this right now. So just when you go home, just experiment with, okay.
Yeah.
Just go up and down the keyboard, kind of listen to those and enjoy them, and say, hey, I'm playing diatonic triads of... They sound like, have some fun with them. Go around, and then if you want to, try different orders of combination. So one is, if you need that gray, try this, or just experiment and be spontaneous and improvise with those different things and listen to the sounds you can get out of them. Okay? Cool. Great work, guys. I'm really impressed.
Yeah,
really good work. You guys are doing really well. Sure.
So feel free to take some posters.
Posters.
And then I'll have your
card. You want us to do anything next?